Hello and welcome to Back to School, the Diwali special. As promised every year, we get in three or four eminent experts from the financial markets to come. We take them to a B school and get them to interact with the students as to what should be the basis of investing in the capital markets, in the current scenario and even otherwise. Four gentlemen with me at the Wellington Institute of Management Studies, need no introduction. Kenneth Andrade, Ramdev Agarwal, Nirmal Jain and Bharat Shah. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining in on this discussion. And Wellingers, thank you so much for having us on your campus. Kenneth, let me start off with you. It's been a rather difficult last 5 years, but without getting into the current scenario, how have you charted investing as a career? I mean, when you are looking at investing, what is it that you look at? It's a broad question, I know, but just maybe start off with an opener.
Look for good companies. But while putting it together, while the terminology might be good companies, but what drives a good company? Okay, and an industry, a company, all have life cycles. So I think the approach that we try to adopt is try and pick up business that you'll never need to sell. So when it does well, it gathers momentum and gathers more market share. In an environment where the market's not doing well, or where the environment's not doing well, it continues to gather more market share. Okay, so across cycles, if you can identify such companies, okay, I think it's pretty easy to hold them through different phases of the market. Okay, and all of this is represented by balance sheets and by how managements effectively approach the way that they do business. So top of the cycle, we like companies not to gear up. Okay, bottom of the cycle, we like to see them coming through with incremental market share and do not destroy shareholder wealth in terms of return on capital employed. I think that's where the stress has been for all of us. This is what we need to do on an optimum basis.
Okay,
so in creating portfolios, I think once you've been able to identify it, irrespective of how the cycle of the industry is behaving, if the company is effectively coming through with a consolidating mode, consolidating other businesses, I think you're very well off trying to hold the company through multiple cycles.
Mm. So Ramdev, you obviously categorize companies into two or three different kind of spaces and then you choose. I've known you since the years and that's what you do.
Yeah.
Is it as simple as that? I mean, what's the basis of choosing a sector or a company, and then, you know, within a top-down approach, how do you come down to the final ones?
Yeah, so let me tell you the process, in the sense that it's a simple four-step process. First, we buy what we understand. Second, the company has to have very good long-term economics. Third, it should be run by competent and honest management. Mm-hmm. And fourth, and only fourth, is the reasonable price. Not very cheap, it need not be very cheap, but should be reasonable. Even if it is a little expensive, it's okay, so long as other criteria are met.
Okay.
So the first thing is the business itself, you know, which you understand, and it should be good. Now, to arrive at a good business, you know, there are businesses and businesses, and that's where this great good gruesome comes in. There are good businesses and there are very good businesses, but that is only maybe 80%. That's about 20-25% of the all the listed companies. If there are 3,000 listed companies, there are 500-600 companies which are good to great. Great is only, say, maybe 100 companies or less than that, 50 companies. Good companies would be another 250 companies. So 300 companies are done. But there are 2,700 companies, they are gruesome. They are not worth investing only. And that's what has populated the market. So how do you avoid them? That's a big effort. So I try to definitely avoid them. So we have to say a lot of companies no, and yet you fall in that trap, even me,
sure,
despite
sure
saying this. So that's the main game. I mean, and then you, if you can get a Nestle or a Titan or a Asian Paint, those kind of businesses at reasonable price, and you can understand that, yes, it is a reasonable price. I think that's a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. But I think, per se, 3-4 investments I do in a year, I think I try to look at good to great companies and at reasonable price.
Mm. Okay, Nirmal, that's an interesting thought. I mean, how do you take it forward? It's very difficult to figure out whether this is a reasonable price or no, because a reasonable price can become an even better price if indeed the market is not in your favor. So how do you figure out when to invest and where to invest?
So I think investing is about as much having brains as stomach, because you can never buy and wish that the next day the stock has to go up. You have to have ability to handle the volatility as well as movements of markets which are not exactly the way you expected. So I think as long as you have conviction that, I think more or less what Kenneth and Ramdev pointed out, those are fundamental principles that last. So if you are convinced that the business is good and has a long-term potential, within that business, the company has the competitive position which is sustainable, is not a business where anybody can come and take away your margins. And of course, the management quality is paramount, because however good the business be, however good the competitive position be, but if you can't trust the management, then you know, this is something where you part with your money and you become the owner, but you are not managing. Mm. So obviously the trust in the management is paramount. I mean, it's something which can't be compromised upon. Mm. And other than that, I think one has to also, if you're an active investor, then you look at the theme and how the smart money is moving. Mm. Because say last 3-4 years, to give you an example, liquidity and institutional interest has become a lot more important than what say it was 5 to 10 years ago. Mm. Because that time the market was driven by a variety of players. So there were small investors, large investors, operators and all kind of people. So if the stock has earnings growth, then you'll see that, you know, there are followers from different segments. But in the last 5 years, what we have seen is that institutional interest and particularly FIs has become very important. Otherwise, sometimes good companies also have to have a long, long wait. So I think these are the factors, which is liquidity and the interest that the company can generate, right, amongst institutional investors, because now the retail is the follower. Mm. You know, they really can't drive the. Once you have conviction, then I think key about investing is that you have to have some longer term. You know, you say people are investing for long term, and the next 2 days the stock price goes down, the person gets nervous and starts calling you. Mm. So unless something fundamentally has gone wrong with your assumption about the business model, I think you have to have patience and have to see through the market price, which, you know, you buy it today, tomorrow it can go down. There's no big deal about it. And once you have patience and a long-term investing approach, then I think it becomes relatively easier to pick up winners.
Okay. Bharat, just wondering, I think something that Kenneth spoke about is probably the kind of investment that you do as well. You look at companies which are having a lifespan across cycles. Is that a reasonable approach for somebody who's not very active? Nirmal spoke about active people looking at flows, etc. and stuff like that. But a lot of retail investors are not really that active. Is looking at companies spanning across life cycles a tool that you believe in?
Yes, I'm not a subscriber of activity as a route for making good returns over a period of time. In fact, I think inactivity is relatively a virtue in good investing, provided you are inactive about the right thing. To my mind, the underlying stock selection criteria are pretty straightforward. And if you scan the history of investing of about 300 years, more or less they remain the same. So which is basically to find a large size of opportunity so that it's a business which is going to get bigger tomorrow than what it is. It's not so much about the past, or it is not so much about how big it is today, but how much bigger it can get tomorrow compared to what it is today. That is the size of idea. Mm. It's more about the size of the pond rather than the size of the fish. While the debate in the market more often is about large cap, small cap, mid cap, the fish, rather than really the size of opportunity, because the size of the fish will fundamentally depend upon the size of the pond. So that's one. Second, which is derived from the first, is why do you want a large pond? Because that gives you an opportunity to create compounding machine, and good investing is all about finding those compounding machines. They don't have to dazzle, they don't have to do some brilliant maverick stuff. They just have to be relentless warriors which can keep growing and growing and growing virtually for a very, very long period of time at what may seem like reasonably ordinary pace, but in a very consistent, predictable, lasting way. And that is the kind of a business which becomes compounding machine, and which typically end up providing you great returns.
Now we can continue this up and about, but before that I just want to get some questions maybe from the students, because they told me that they would want to ask some questions to you guys. So any hands out there, if you have a question, please raise your hand and the mic will come to you.
Hello sir, my name is Pritesh Nimbalkar and my question is to Ramdev sir. Sir, considering the volatility in the market, for a new investor, is it good for him to invest in defensive sector like FMCG or the pharma sector?
So the issue is that what you understand. The first point is what you understand. If you have a pharmaceutical background in terms of undergrad, or you have a pharmacy business, or somehow you have friends around because of which you can understand pharma or consumer products, clearly you must go and because how do you understand? Because you don't understand. There are say 120 listed industries, and everybody has a potential to understand 5-7 industries well, and even 5-7 is also too much. 3-4 you'll have a natural liking for it for some reason. And I think if you pick up if you are a say auto analyst for 4-5 years, so typically what happens is that your understanding of entire auto space is fantastic, and your strike rate will be much better. So it all starts from what you understand. So if you understand consumer and pharma very well, there is no reason why you should not be having. But if I don't understand, like pharma, it is at times very difficult for me to pronunciate the pharmaceutical ingredients and all. So at times I don't know why that particular drug is used for, and what is the size of the opportunity in that particular drug, how many players are there. So then I'm not comfortable analyzing each and every ingredient. So it's all question of understanding that particular industry. So neither pharmaceutical is right nor wrong. It depends on your understanding.
Good evening, sir. I'm Anupriya Rath, and my question is for Kenneth, sir. Sir, we have been observing high saving rates among people, but still there is a dearth of investors in equity markets. So why is it so, and what can be done?
I think, and this is what has come up over the last 10 years or 14 years since capital markets have become, or equity investing did become popular in 2007 and 2008. And as we come to the end of the cycle, I think between mutual funds, the best performing asset class has ended up being liquid funds. Okay, so India's a context wherein you have very high double-digit returns from fixed income, and you have equity asset classes which are reasonably volatile and always get sold at the last at a wrong period of time. It's also an industry which is only 20 years old, so it's not really matured to any degree, and we're still building from an industry part, still building building profitability. From an investor part, is still getting used to cycles. So between equity and fixed income, equity as a part of the industry is about 20%, and fixed income is about 80%. So mutual funds have gone down to the retail investor, but it's happened in the fixed income business, wherein the returns are less volatile and more sure. So India is very traditional in that sense. You've got fixed income, and you've obviously got real estate and gold, which has mopped up significant amount of assets. We also need to realize that gold and real estate have been one of the two asset classes, or both of them have beaten inflation over an extremely long period of time, which is why there's an attraction towards that part of that market.
Good evening, sir. My name is Nishant Thakkar. My question is to Nirmal, sir. Sir, how should an investor look at DVR shares as an investment option?
So if you are looking at investing in India, then I don't think you look at the deferred opportunities vis-a-vis existing. So it's more a theoretical question from Indian context, or unless anybody else has a different view. So
globally, is there a difference between investing in DVRs versus the normal share?
I actually have never delved into too much into this.
DVR concept became very famous because of the telco DVR, which was issued and at a significant discount. And the stock did very well, so the discount between the underlying common stock and the DVR has been significant. That's not the global experience. So actually it's an opportunity here, because the understanding of DVR is, because they are giving even more dividend also. So if you are a minority shareholder, you must, I would think if you are a true investor, you must sell your underlying and buy into, if DVR form is available at 20, 30, 40% discount, because you are going to get 30% more yield onto what you have invested. So it makes a common sense to convert into DVR.
Okay, what I'll do is I'll just do a very quick 10-minute rapid fire of sorts, so that we can just get in more comments from each of our guests. So I'll just try and make the question and the answers a bit quick as well. Kenneth, one quick thing that a lot of people get swayed in, until I started my MBA finance, I never realized that there are times when a leveraged company could actually provide better returns if indeed it is in a bit of an up cycle. And most people would believe that a debt-free company is the best choice. What's the difference really?
I think you have to invest across economic cycles and look where the company actually leverages. On top of the cycle, I don't think leverage is good.
Okay.
No, I prefer moderate leverage at any point of the cycle. Hmm.
So, Ramdev, would that be the case for an active investor as well? Or does he take his chances with maybe some companies which are well managed, have a high bit of leverage, and therefore maybe the returns would be higher because of the benefits of taxation? Or just don't look at that path at all?
Leverage is, I don't have any option in the company. Company tells us that they are leveraged more than 2 times, 3 times.
Right.
I would think that in most of the companies, normal leverage is about 1 time. I'm not talking about banks or NBFCs, which is 6 times, 10 times and all. But in non-financial companies, if the leverage is 1 time or maybe a little more in a growth phase, they have some 1 time big capex or something like that, you could be tolerant. But otherwise, if it is excessively an interest coverage is not good, then you have to be very careful, because these companies, they have threat of going down.
Right. Nirmal, just wondering, a lot of companies, even in the current context, are having a good growth and are trading at premium valuations. And there are companies which have probably had dismal growth for the past few years and are trading at abysmally cheap valuations. What does an average investor do? Because he's very tempted to look at businesses which have lasted for the last 15, 20, 25 years, but because of the last 5 years' difficulty, are trading at really cheap valuations. Does one look at them or just discard them?
No, I think what matters is future outlook and not the past or even present for that matter.
Right.
So unless the more or less market would discount it. So I mean, if you just have to take one of the two choices, I'll still go with the high growth IP stocks rather than the beaten down companies, because market is not expecting them to grow. But whenever there's the stocks which are beaten down also give you turnaround opportunities, because when the cycles turn, then not only their growth earnings improve, their P multiple also improve.
Okay.
So, you know, you can't have a magic rule that, okay, or a formula based investing. It depends on case to case. But broadly, I mean, if I were to take a blind call amongst the two, I'll prefer the high growth, high PE.
Bharat, come in on this one. There are consumption stocks trading at 40, 50 PEs, as the case may be, as you look at the valuations of 1 year hence. And there are people who are arguing, saying that there's no reason why these companies can't go to 100 times. Now, the question is that a good way to look at it? Or do you kind of keep them in your portfolio or keep a trailing stop or book profits there and look at cheaper companies?
No, the idea can never be to buy a quality business at unreasonable valuation. That cannot be hypothesis of any good investing.
Okay.
But I dispute what you are saying, that consumption stocks are quoting at 40 and 50 times. There are only one or two which are quoting at what may look like closer to those numbers.
Mm.
Most of the others are still trading at about 30 times or thereabouts. Now, if these businesses are generating return on capital employed upwards of 35, 40, 50%, if they have dividend payout ratios exceeding 50%, and if they are growing at a reasonable pace of 15-20% for a very, very long period of time, and have a promise to do so, I would say 20-25 times is not some aberrantly high valuation at all. An idea of trying to buy at arithmetically cheap looking price is the bugbear, because that doesn't really take into account the quality of the earnings, the replicability, the episodicity of the earnings, the longevity, and the character part. These are all very vital parts that you need to analyze to arrive at what is reasonable valuation. In any case, I think price earning multiple itself is a very defective way of valuing business, because it's an optical illusion, and that's not fundamentally a good way of valuing. Price earning multiple overemphasizes short term at the expense of long term.
In isolation, surely not. But one last question, Kenneth, to you before we wrap up this show. What goes into you, because you meet a lot of managements who try to convince you that the business is looking good, etc. And I had a couple of people who wanted to ask this question to one of the panelists, so I'm just asking it to you, that there are so many times when we get caught on the wrong foot. Satyam is a classic case, but there are tons of others. I mean, the latest episodes in say FT, for example, probably a case in point too. How does one identify, because you probably have access to the management, to day-to-day reports, an average investor doesn't. How does he identify these things if he wants to invest firsthand into equities?
I think all the cases you cited was a case of fraud, and out there there's very little whether you are informed or uninformed to actually capture it on your book. So you will always hit these minefields at points in time. But when you're effectively buying a business, you're effectively buying a franchise which has lasted a period of time. You've got a look and feel of the entire business. They've been around for some time. They've respected capital. They've been good to their stakeholders. And when I say stakeholders, it's been to the government, it's been to the shareholders, it's been to the bondholders. So if you're stepping, you're doing a stepping stone into investing, okay, don't buy companies which are coming to this, broken into the scene yesterday. Okay, and the only thing that's going to last for you is your product and your governance. I think if you hold this together, I think your investment should be safe over a period of time.
Gentlemen, thanks so much. It's been a pleasure having you on this leg of Back to School and giving your insights into the basics of investing and, of course, the current market scenario. And to the television viewers as well, thanks so much for joining in on this leg of Back to School. From all of us out here on the podium and in the audience, wishing you guys a very happy Diwali and a prosperous and a profitable new year investing into equities. Thanks so much.